Good morning. Okay, I'm very grateful to Arthipuram's DPS for inviting me here. And when I looked at the lineup and I met some of the young people who are talking, I really wanted to turn tail. I wanted to run away from here and say, thank you, but no thank you, I'm not talking. You're all too young. And I think I've been here for a very long time. When I look at, probably most of you, when I look at you, most of you, your parents, maybe your mothers were in primary school when I started working with primary school children. So you can understand that's a long time ago. Right? I'm as old as a dinosaur, I think. But in 1970, when I started Katha, I started working with children, there were a lot of things that were happening at that point of time. But many things have changed, many, many things. We have more artificial intelligence today, we have the mobile phones, we have all these young people doing amazing things, awesome things. But one thing that hasn't changed is education, I think. We are still stuck with some kind of a pattern which was left for us by the British. So we have children who are docile, who say, yes ma'am, no ma'am, I will do this ma'am. And if they look beyond that, they are not in schools like DPS, but across India I'm talking about. I think this is happening. We are looking at a lot of children who are not able to stand up and do what they want to be doing. In 1970, when we started, the kind of education system we had been handed over to us by the British, right? So we had a British way of teaching children. They wanted babus, they wanted people who would listen to them, who would do the kind of things that they wanted to be done. They thought that they were the leaders and we were the people who were following them. But today, we have an amazing group of children over here, leaders who are trying to do things for our country and for the world. If you know, India has the most number of young people in the world. We have 66% of people below the age of 35. And if you look at the kind of sum total of change that can happen in our country because of each one of you, I think it's amazing. People like us who belong to a long time ago, we can just stand on the sidelines and cheer and say, well done, just go ahead and do it. We just want you to go and do it. Set right all the things that we messed up in our lives, I think. We'd like you to do that. Do you think you'll be able to do something like that? Because I think our generation messed up quite a few things. So I want you guys to come in and do something which will make change happen. Okay? In 1990, when I started Katha, 1988 when I started Katha, the main idea was, is it possible for us to have a school which was different? I didn't start off that way. I started off thinking, because I landed up in one of the huge, largest slum clusters of Delhi, I started off thinking, is there something that we can do for children? Is there something that we can look at equitable learning for children? So I went there and I started off very similar to ways in which other schools started off. Examinations, tests, you know, telling children what they should be doing, getting them to do these things. I wanted 50 children. I managed to get 5 children. I didn't know why I just had 5 children. God knows that there were 200 times that number in the slums that I was working in. So why were the children not coming? When I started looking at the ways in which we are teaching our children, I thought that maybe if we can change things. So the first thing I did was to throw out all the textbooks. I said no textbooks at all in our school. So we threw out the textbook, threw out the testing, and we started listening to the children. The idea was to get the stories from the children. They were coming from different areas. They were coming from Haryana, they were coming from Rajasthan, coming from UP, coming from West Bengal. We had some children from Bangladesh, which the government of India then said, no way. You could not have children from Bangladesh. And I said, yes, we do. But we kept it very quiet. Because we knew that they were from Bangladesh. Anyway, that's a different story altogether. So what happened was, here were this set of children, and we started listening to them. We were getting this Rajasthani story. We were getting this little song that was coming from Bhojpuri. We were getting a little thing about from a child who said that, you know, her mother had gone on the Hajj and had sent a story from there. And so we heard that story. So we were hearing a lot of stories from the children. We were celebrating languages. We were celebrating linguistic cultures of our children. And story became the main thing that was leading our children into education. With story and with the way in which the children were participating, interacting, getting to know one another. It was like theater, like one of the teachers here said. It was like theater. It was bringing in a lot of excitement, which came from the children. It was not coming from teachers, though I had amazing teachers with me. So the 5 slowly became 350. The 350 became slowly 1,000. And then we had 1,600 children. We didn't have room for them at all. We just didn't have room. We had to close down. We thought we'll have to close down. We didn't have the money to do it. We didn't have anything at all. But the school was spreading news to different communities, you know, some communities around. So parents were coming to us and saying, aisa school hame bhi chahiye. Why are you not giving us a school like this? Why can't we have something like this in our centers? But we didn't have the money for it, right? So our children stepped in at that point. So this story is all about our children and how they decided that they could make a change. And I can tell you, when children decide that they can make the change, they can rock the world. It's a tectonic change that can happen because there are so many of you and so many creative ideas out there. And that's what our children did. So we had a small group of children in our school who said that we will go into the neighboring slums and we'll make the change. So we started off with 22 slums where our children went, and it was enhancing the joy of reading that they did. They brought the other children into reading, into listening to stories, into telling their own stories, recording those stories. So that's how we started. Today, we are in more than 200 slums. We have looked at change that should be happening across. And at this point of time, I want to mention the kind of things that make change happen. I think in India, we are looking at something that I would like to call Shravana Shakti. You know, the ability to listen and make change happen. It's not like in other countries where reading and books came a long time ago, when Gutenberg came in, he brought in all these books and everything, and change started happening there, industrialization started happening there. But when you're looking at India, we are looking at a community, a large number of children who learn from listening, from the oral traditions. So when you look at dance and music and drama, and you look at all the oral ways in which we communicate, which is what is happening in today's internet generation, all of you are communicating in different ways, which are not actually the written word. So you're moving back again into the oral tradition, back again into smileys and things like that, which are helping you to communicate and to link with humanity, with people out there, build relationships, which is what was happens with the oral tradition. And that is what we were taking forward. Now, when I look at the spunky children that we have, the 1,500 do-its that we have, we call them the do-its. They started, we call it the Delhi One Young Team. They are the do-its. They just go out there and they do it, okay? Now, what they started doing was very interesting. They had about 8 adults with them. But it was 1,400 of these students who had volunteered to come into the whole program. So they go into the community, and they inspire, they, you know, motivate, they propel and impel the other children to join them in storytelling. So we formed the leagues. So we had a Nibandrani league, for instance. Children who were really interested in the essay and, you know, talking about the essay. We had a storytelling group. We had other groups. So there were all these little leagues that were forming. And the leagues got together and they would have league matches, which was on reading. So you would have a card, for instance, with tomato written on it, and you'll just show it. If they could sort of look at the card and they could enact tomato, then we said, okay, children are able to read, so it's great. So we are looking at ways in which we are getting children into reading without actually making them feel a lack of self-esteem or a lack of confidence, saying that, you know, I can't do this, I have been working. Because for many of these children, believe me, I think the hammer and the chisel were more in place in their hands than the pencil. The pencil somehow suddenly started looking so huge and so big when you put it into the hands of these children. They were so comfortable holding the hammer and handling the chisel. So how do you move them with great felicity from an oral tradition into a written tradition? How do you bring them into writing and into reading from books? So that was a challenge that the do-its were facing. At this point of time, I would like to talk about how, for me, I was rewriting the books on poverty. You say, I come from a middle-class family like everyone in this room. My parents were very good to me, very kind to me. They allowed me, my mother would get up in the middle of the night to make tea and coffee. Coffee, because I come from South India. So coffee for me, because I'm studying late into the night. So my father would be there saying, you know, the parchitya, have you got this ready? Have you got that ready? Fussing around me, doing things for me. And I grew up in that. I'm sure many of you are growing up in an environment like that, right? So I grew up in that kind of an environment. I thought that education was to get children into IITs and IIMs. I never for the life of me thought that I was looking at children who could not even get into class 12. So when I was looking at the Goldilocks, you all know Goldilocks, right? Okay, so I am there looking at the Goldilocks debate. You know, is our class hot and sexy enough? Is it very cold and pedantic? Is it just enough? Can I give them something which is, you know, more of, you know, interactions, less of textbooks? When I'm looking at all these things, the children are going out and doing their own things, right? They are making things happen. And I think when I look at the way in which we look at poverty in our country, we sometimes think that they are all people from Mars. I don't know what they want. I don't know what they need. I don't know how to give them these things. So let them stay where they are. So they become this invisible mass. We see them all around. Yesterday in my work, I look and there are these buildings going up in our colony. And there are all these children out there. Nobody, we are not worried about them, okay? Because we are all reaching out to something different. But as a country, what is the intergenerational gift that we can give to our children, to our country? Because many of us here probably will continue to live in India. India is also becoming a very hot destination for job opportunities. Most people are thinking, I'd much rather be in India than be outside the country. So many people are coming back to this country. So if there is an intergenerational gift that we want to give to our children, what will that be? And how should we give that? Okay? And I'm thinking that if we look at all of you over here, we look at the young people of India, we look at the young people of Delhi, is there a way in which we can make this happen? One of the things that comes to my mind is, of course, looking at the city of Delhi that we are all living in today. Though I know many people have come from outside of Delhi also, but looking at the city of Delhi, we have 1700 slums. We have about 3,000 government schools in our city. They say 50% of Delhi is living in slums or living in poverty. Let me not even say slums, living in poverty, right? They may be living on the street, they may be living in slums. Maybe all people living in slums are not poor. Maybe all people living out of the slums are not rich. But we have a 50% which is not making ends meet. And we are looking at children like you, the other 50% who can come in. So when you look at 16 million people who inhabit the city of Delhi, and we say that, okay, maybe keeping the demographics in place, it is about 66% living in poverty, 66% youth, then is it possible for us to look at all of you coming in and doing something with the other? Right? If we can do that, we can work for equity, we can work for equitable opportunities for all, we can look at equitable fun and learning for all. Do you think, I'm talking to all of you, do you think that's possible at all? Yes? No? Can I hear anything?
Yes?
Yes. Okay. Now, here is an idea that I would like to share with you. Supposing we say that we have the 1400 DOYTs. Now, they need a lot of help. They've been able to get into 200 slums. Okay. But I told you we have 1700 slums over here in Delhi. Now, many of them are near schools that have labs, that have good things happening over there. Lovely teachers, you have everything. Now, supposing we say that each of you, each class, for instance, touches one of these groups of children, and we say that we are able to make a difference in their lives. I think that is something that will be possible. It will not stretch anyone at all, but at the same time, it will make us feel more human, make us feel more in link, in touch with other people. And we will move out of this syndrome that we had, because we are moving into a globalized world. We are looking at the global village. We all know we are looking at the global village. We don't want foreigners to come here and say, we will give you aid and we will give you. I think we as a country, we are quite capable of helping ourselves. Thank you very much. So I know that the Delhi One young team that we have, they are not like a boulder. They don't make this big splash. They don't make things happen in a very, very big way. They are invisible. They are quiet. They are moving in these slums and doing it. But a pebble can also make a lake ripple, right? And if there are more pebbles, if each one of you becomes that little pebble which makes the lake of Delhi ripple, can we have a little wave over here? Can we say that we make Delhi into the reading capital of India? Is it possible? Is it at all possible for us to say, let's do it for Delhi? Can I hear you all say, let's do it for Delhi? Would you like to do it for Delhi?
Yes.
Yes? Okay, great. Now you'll find that there's a small sheet of paper on your chairs. And if you think that you would like to do something, then please put down your ideas. There's a little fishbowl over here. And you can drop your ideas into this. If you can do things in your own way, in your own little worlds. But let's make it happen. Thank you very much.